Good evening. When young people are told the truth, they have an enormous sense of relief. This is a quote by Howard Zinn, whom we honor this evening in this event, celebrating the publication of A People's History of the United States and Voices of the People's History of the United States. My name is Mary Watson. I'm the Executive Dean of the New School for Public Engagement, a division of the New School University formed nearly 100 years ago as a place of free expression, open dialogue, a place to really question what is the purpose of education and higher education in particular, a place to challenge assumptions, and a place to explore the problems that face our society year after year as we found this almost 100-year history behind us. I was a child before Howard Zinn wrote his book, which I guess says something about my own age. And I have a young child myself now. About 3 years ago, my daughter, whose name is Amy, came home from school and said, "Mom, today we wrote an essay about Christopher Columbus." And I said, "Ah, Indigenous Peoples Day, right?" She said, "No, there's this thing called Columbus Day, Mom. And I wrote this essay, and I want to show it to you." So she showed me this piece of paper, and on this paper she had written, "People say that Christopher Columbus was a good person." This is paraphrased. "But I don't think that he is, because he came to look for a place that had already been discovered by the Inuit, the Cherokee, the Aztec, the Menominee, the Onondaga, and the Cree, and other indigenous people. He came to look for gold, which he couldn't find. And so when he didn't find the gold, he went back to the king and queen and said, 'Here are some slaves that I'll bring you in place of the gold that I'd promised you.' And they liked that. And so he went back and got some more." And I said, and I remember, he's like 9 years old when this is happening. I said, "How do you know all of this?" And she said, "Well, we learned this song. It's called 1492. Some of you may know this song. It's written by Nancy, what's her last name, Schimler. And the lyric is something like, you know, 'Columbus sailed the ocean blue, et cetera, et cetera. It was a courageous thing to do, but he couldn't discover the place because the people were already there.'" So as I look back on my own history and the people's history of the United States, and I ask myself, what did I learn when I was a young child versus what did my daughter learn when she was a young child, I have discovered that many people, but including, and perhaps tonight most importantly, Howard Zinn, have made a significant contribution to reshaping the way in which young people understand American history. So we are here tonight in the grand tradition of the New School to look and re-examine and ask questions about things that we think we already know, and to celebrate the 10th anniversary of the wonderful book that Howard edited with Anthony Arnov, the primary resource companion to the monumental book, A People's History of the United States, called The Voices of the People's History of the United States, 10 years today. We are very honored at the New School to host this event tonight at our new Tishman Auditorium. We welcome you here, and now I'd like to introduce Anthony Arnov to introduce and narrate tonight's performance. Welcome.
Thanks so much. It's my real privilege to introduce this evening's performance. I'll be brief. I'll just do a couple quick housekeeping announcements. If you happen to have on you a National Security Agency tracking device that might look something like this, please silence it. You'll see some video cameras here. They're filming so that you don't have to. So you can put away your cameras. If you want to take a selfie during the show, don't use a flash. We wouldn't want you to hurt your eyes. I also want to just thank a couple of people. You'll see in your program a number of people who made tonight possible, but I just want to again thank Pamela Tillis and the whole crew here at the New School for making this wonderful space available to us and everything that they've done to make tonight such a success. Also, tonight marks the 10th year of this book, Voices of a People's History of the United States, which was published with great visionary insight by Seven Stories Press, Dan Simon, Ruth Wiener, and all the team there. I want to thank them for all the support over the last 10 years, for really being at the heart of everything that has been possible as a result of this project. And you'll note that when you came in the lobby, there were copies of the book, and please support independent publishing. get copies of the book for yourself, for your friends, for your family, for teachers you know. Don't get it through Amazon, please. Get it through the publisher. Get it, support Haymarket Books, which is here tonight helping to sell those books. I also want to thank some of the people who were with me from the very beginning of this journey with Howard. Jesse Kindig, who's here tonight from Indiana, who worked with Howard and I on the very first performance in 2003, gathering those very earliest documents that we read in the very first performance before the book was even out. Brenda Coughlin, who's been motivating and driving this project from the very beginning and throughout the last 10 years running the organization, Voices of a People's History of the United States. Mariah Newroth, who's been heading our Chicago project. So many more people who I would like to acknowledge, but really I want to move on as quickly as I can to this wonderful set of performers we have tonight. And just say that Howard's spirit is so part of everything that these performers bring to this evening's event, and that really his work continues to be so meaningful and so long-lasting and so impactful since his passing. But it's really incumbent upon all of us to continue the legacy of his contribution to building and making people's history. So now, really, it's my tremendous privilege to bring to the stage Allison Moore. In January of 1964, inspired by sit-in demonstrators in Durham, North Carolina, who he had met after a performance there, and also angered by his arrest in Shreveport, Louisiana, after he and his band members tried to check in at a white motel, Sam Cooke recorded a song that would become an anthem of the U.S. civil rights movement, "A Change Is Gonna Come."
I was born by the river in a little tent. Oh, and just like that river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die, 'cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. It will. Then I go to my brother. And I say, brother, help me please. But it winds up knocking me back down to my knees. Oh, there have been times when I thought couldn't last for long, but now I think very home. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been a long time coming, but I know. Change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
3 years after the financial crisis of 2008 hit, on September 17th, 2011, hundreds and then thousands of people flooded into Zuccotti Park in the heart of New York City's financial district. Catalyzed by the people's movements erupting around the globe, protesters occupied the square for weeks, united under the slogan, "We are the 99%," and put economic inequality squarely into the mainstream of national discourse. Author and activist Naomi Klein delivered this speech in Zuccotti Park in October 2011 using the people's mic.
I love you. And I didn't just say that so hundreds of you would shout, "I love you" back. Though that is obviously a bonus feature of the human microphone. Say unto others what you would have them say unto you, only way louder. Yesterday, one of the speakers at the rally said, "We found each other." That sentiment captures the beauty of what is being created here. A wide open space, as well as an idea so big it can't be contained by any space, for all the people who want a better world to find each other. We are so grateful. If there is one thing I know, it is that the 1% loves a crisis. When people are panicked and desperate and no one seems to know what to do, that is the ideal time to push through their wish list of pro-corporate policies, privatizing education and Social Security, slashing public services, getting rid of the last constraints on corporate power. Amidst the economic crisis, this is happening the world over. And there is only one thing that can block this tactic, and fortunately, it's a very big thing. It's the 99%. And that 99% is taking to the streets from Madison to Madrid to say, "No, we will not pay for your crisis." That slogan began in Italy in 2008. It ricocheted to Greece and France and Ireland, and finally it has made its way to the square mile where the crisis began. "Why are they protesting?" asked the baffled pundits on TV. Meanwhile, the rest of the world asks, "What took you so long? We've been wondering when you were going to show up. And most of all, welcome." Many people have drawn parallels between Occupy Wall Street and the so-called anti-globalization protests that came to the world's attention in Seattle in 1999. That was the last time a global, youth-led, decentralized movement took direct aim at a corporate power. But there are important differences, too. For instance, we chose summits as our targets. The World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, the G8. Summits are transient by their nature. They only last a week, and that made us transient, too. We'd appear, grab world headlines, then disappear. And in the frenzy of hyperpatriotism and militarism that followed the September 11 attacks, it was easy to sweep us away completely, at least in North America. Occupy Wall Street, on the other hand, has chosen a fixed target, and you have put no end date on your presence here. This is wise. Only when you stay put can you grow roots. This is crucial. It is a fact of the information age that too many movements spring up like beautiful flowers, but quickly die off. It's because they don't have roots. and they don't have a long-term plan for how they are going to sustain themselves. So when storms come, they get washed away. Being horizontal and deeply democratic is wonderful, but these principles are compatible with the hard work of building structures and institutions that are sturdy enough to weather the storms ahead. I have great faith that this will happen. Something else this movement is doing right. You have committed yourselves to nonviolence. You have refused to give the media the images of broken windows and street fights it craves so desperately. And that tremendous discipline has meant that again and again, the story has been the disgraceful and unprovoked police brutality, which we saw more of just last night. Meanwhile, support for this movement grows and grows, more wisdom. But the biggest difference a decade makes is that in 1999, we were taking on capitalism at the peak of a frenzied economic boom. Unemployment was low, stock portfolios were bulging, the media was drunk on easy money. Back then, it was all about startups, not shutdowns. We pointed out that the deregulation behind the frenzy came at a price. It was damaging to labor standards. It was damaging to environmental standards. Corporations were becoming more powerful than governments, and that was damaging to our democracies. But while the good times rolled, it took an economic system based on greed, and that was a tough sell, at least in rich countries. Now, 10 years later, it seems as if there aren't any more rich countries, just a whole lot of rich people. People who got rich looting the public wealth and exhausting natural resources around the world. The point is, today everyone can see that the system is deeply unjust and careening out of control. Unfettered greed has trashed the global economy, and it is trashing the natural world as well. We are overfishing our oceans, polluting our water with fracking and deep water drilling, turning to the dirtiest forms of energy on the planet, like the Alberta tar sands. And the atmosphere cannot absorb that amount of carbon we are putting into it, creating dangerous warming. The new normal is serial disasters, economic and ecological. We all know, or at least sense, that the world is upside down. We act as if there is no end to what is actually finite, fossil fuels, and the atmospheric space to absorb their emissions. And we act as if there are strict and immovable limits to what is actually bountiful, the financial resources to build the kind of society we need. The task of our time is to turn this around, to challenge this false scarcity, to insist that we can afford to build a decent, inclusive society, while at the same time respect the real limits to what the Earth can take. What climate change means is that we have to do this on a deadline. This time, our movement cannot get distracted, divided, burned out, or swept away by events. This time we have to succeed. And I'm not talking about regulating the banks and increasing taxes on the rich, though that's important. I am talking about changing the underlying values that govern our society. That is hard to fit into a single media-friendly demand, and it's also hard to figure out how to do it. But it is no less urgent for being difficult. That is what I see happening in this square. In the way you are feeding each other, keeping each other warm, sharing information freely, and improving healthcare, meditation classes, and empowerment training. My favorite sign here says, "I care about you." In a culture that trains people to avoid each other's gaze, to say, "Let them die," that is a deeply radical statement. A few final thoughts. In this great struggle, here are some things that don't matter. What we wear, whether we shake our fists or make peace signs, whether we can fit our dreams for a better world into a media soundbite. Here are a few things that do matter. Our courage, our moral compass, how we treat each other. We have picked a fight with the most powerful economic and political forces on the planet. That's frightening. Always be aware that there will be a temptation to shift to smaller targets, like, say, the person sitting next to you. After all, that is a battle that's easier to win. Don't give in to this temptation. I'm not saying don't call each other on shit. But this time, let's treat each other as if we plan to work side by side in struggle for many, many years to come. Because the task before us will demand nothing less. Let's treat this beautiful movement as if it is the most important thing in the world. Because it is. It really is.
In recent years, the idealized, romanticized picture of Christopher Columbus has been increasingly challenged. Evidence for this more critical view comes in part from Bartolomé de las Casas, who saw firsthand the consequences of Columbus's conquest, which he described in these words, first published in 1542.
The Indies were discovered in the year 1492. 49 years have passed since the first settlers penetrated these lands, the first being the large and most happy isle called Hispaniola, perhaps the most densely populated place in the world. There must be close to 200 leagues of land on this island, and all the land so far discovered is a beehive of people. It is as though God had crowded into these lands the great majority of mankind. And of all the infinite universe of humanity, these people are the most guileless, the most devoid of wickedness and duplicity, the most obedient and faithful to their native masters and to the Spanish Christians whom they serve. And because they are so weak and complacent, they are less able to endure heavy labor and soon die of no matter what malady. Yet into this sheepfold, into this land of meek outcasts, there came some Spaniards who immediately behaved like ravening wild beasts. Wolves, tigers, or lions that had been starved for many days. Killing, terrorizing, afflicting, torturing, and destroying the native peoples, doing all this with the strangest and most varied new methods of cruelty, never seen or heard of before. And to such a degree that this island of Hispaniola, once so populous, having a population that I estimated to be more than 3 million, has now a population of barely 200 persons. Their reason for killing and destroying such an infinite number of souls is that the Christians have an ultimate aim, which is to acquire gold and to swell themselves with riches in a very brief time and thus rise to a high estate disproportionate to their merits. Sounds familiar. It should be kept in mind that their insatiable greed and ambition, the greatest ever seen in the world, is the cause of their villainies. And also, those lands are so rich and felicitous, the native people so meek and patient, so easy to subject, that our Spaniards have no more consideration for them than beasts. No, for thanks be to God, they have treated beasts with some respect. I should say instead that they were treated like excrement on the public squares. The Indians began to seek ways to throw the Christians out of their lands. They took up arms, but their weapons were very weak and of little service in offense and still less in defense. The Christians, with their horses and swords and pikes, began to carry out massacres and strange cruelties against them. They attacked the towns and spared neither the children nor the aged, nor the pregnant women, nor women in childbed, not only stabbing them and dismembering them, but cutting them to pieces as if dealing with sheep in the slaughterhouse. They made some low, wide gallows on which the feet of the hanged almost touched the ground, stringing up their victims in lots of 13 in memory of our Redeemer and his 12 apostles. Then set burning wood at their feet and thus roasted them alive. When tied to the stake, the cacique Hatue, a very important noble, was told by a Franciscan friar about the God of the Christians and of the Articles of Faith. And he was told, what he could do in the brief time that remained to him in order to be saved and go to heaven. The cacique, who had never heard any of this before and was told he would go to hell, where if he did not adopt the Christian faith, he would suffer eternal torment, asked the Franciscan friar if Christians all went to heaven. When told that they did, he said he would prefer to go to hell.
July 4th is held, one of the great figures of early Native resistance to colonization was Tecumseh, a Shawnee leader. Here he speaks to the Osages about the struggle against the colonists as they expanded westward.
Brothers, we all belong to one family. We are the children of the Great Spirit. We walk in the same path, slake our thirst at the same spring. Brothers, we are friends. We must assist each other to bear our burdens. The blood of many of our fathers and brothers has run like water on the ground so to satisfy the avarice of the white men. We ourselves are threatened with a great evil. Nothing will pacify them but the destruction of all the red men. Brothers, when the white men first set foot on our grounds, they were hungry. They had no place on which to spread their blankets or to kindle their fires. They were feeble. They could do nothing for themselves. Our father commiserated their distress and shared freely with them whatever the Great Spirit had given his red children. They gave them food when hungry, medicine when sick, spread skins for them to sleep on, and gave them grounds that they may hunt and raise corn. Brothers, the white people are like poisonous serpents. When chilled, they are feeble and harmless, but invigorate them with warmth and they sting their benefactors to death. The white people came among us feeble, and now we have made them strong. They wish to kill us or drive us back as they would wolves and panthers. Brothers, the white men are not friends to the Indians. At first, they only asked for land sufficient for a wigwam. Now nothing will satisfy them but the whole of our hunting grounds from the rising to the setting sun. Brothers, who are the white people that we should fear them? They cannot run fast and are good marks to shoot at. They are only men. Our fathers have killed many of them. We will stain the earth red with blood. Brothers, we must be united. We must smoke the same pipe. We must fight each other's battles, and more than all, we must love the Great Spirit. He is for us. He will destroy our enemies and make all his red children happy.
July 4th is held up as a day to celebrate the struggle for freedom and independence. But the great abolitionist Frederick Douglass, himself a former slave and the editor of the abolitionist newspaper, The North Star, dared to challenge the exaltation of the holiday. Here is part of his remarkable address to the Rochester, New York Ladies Anti-Slavery Society.
Friends, fellow citizens, he who could address this audience without a quailing sensation has stronger nerves than I have. I do not remember ever to have appeared as a speaker before any assembly more shrinkingly nor with greater distrust of my ability than I do this day. A feeling has crept over me, quite unfavorable to the exercise of my limited powers of speech. The papers and placards say that I am to deliver a 4th of July oration. Fellow citizens, pardon me. Allow me to ask, why am I called upon to speak here today? What have I, or those I represent, to do with your national independence? Are the great principles of political freedom and of natural justice embodied in that Declaration of Independence extended to us? Would to God, both for your sakes and ours, that an affirmative answer could be truthfully returned to these questions. Then would my task be light and my burden easy and delightful. But such is not the state of the case. I say it with a sad sense of the disparity between us. Your independence only reveals the immeasurable distance between us, the rich inheritance of justice, liberty, and prosperity bequeathed by your fathers is shared by you, not by me. The sunlight that brought light and healing to you has brought stripes and death to me. This 4th of July is yours, not mine. To drag a man in fetters into the temple of liberty and call upon him to join you in joyous anthems is sacrilegious irony. Do you mean, citizens, to mock me, asking me to speak here today? Oh, had I the ability, I would pour out a fiery stream of biting ridicule, blasting reproach, withering sarcasm, and stern rebuke. For it is not light that is needed, but fire. It is not the gentle shower, but thunder. We need the storm, the whirlwind, and the earthquake. The conscience of the nation must be aroused. The hypocrisy of the nation must be exposed, and its crimes against God and man must be denounced. What to the American slave is your 4th of July? I answer, a day that reveals to him, more than all other days of the year, the gross injustice and cruelty to which he is the constant victim. To him, your celebration is a sham. Your boasted liberty, an unholy license. Your national greatness, swelling vanity. Your sounds of rejoicing, empty and heartless. Your shouts of liberty and equality, hollow mockery. Your prayers and hymns are to him mere bombast, fraud, impiety, and hypocrisy. A thin veil to cover up crimes which would disgrace a nation of savages. There is not a nation on the earth guilty of practices more shocking and bloody than are the people of the United States at this very hour. Go where you may, search where you will. Roam through all the monarchies and despotisms of the old world. Search out every abuse. And when you have found the last, lay your facts by the side of the everyday practices of this nation, and you will say with me that for revolting barbarity and shameless hypocrisy, America reigns without rival.
One of the most eloquent voices against war was that of Eugene Debs, the railroad union organizer and leader of the Socialist Party. On June 18, 1918, he addressed a mass rally of workers in Ohio, knowing very well that his words could lead, as they did, to his arrest and imprisonment. His sentence of 10 years was upheld by a unanimous Supreme Court decision. Here is the speech that led to his arrest.
Sam Johnson declared that patriotism is the last refuge of the scoundrel. He must have had the Wall Street gentry in mind, or at least their prototypes. For in every age, it has been the tyrant, the oppressor, and the exploiter who has wrapped himself in the cloak of patriotism, or religion, or both, to deceive and overawe the people. Every solitary one of these aristocratic conspirators and would-be murderers claims to be an arch patriot. Every one of them insists that war is being waged to make the world safe for democracy? What humbug, what rot, what false pretense. Wars throughout history have been waged for conquest and plunder. In the Middle Ages, when the feudal lords concluded to enlarge their domains, to increase their power, their prestige, and their wealth, they declared war on one another. But they themselves did not go to war any more than modern feudal lords, the barons of Wall Street, go to war. The feudal barons of the Middle Ages, the economic predecessors of the capitalists of today, declared all wars, and their miserable serfs fought all battles. And that is war in a nutshell. The master class has always declared the wars. The subject class has always fought the battles. The master class has had all to gain and nothing to lose, while the subject class has had nothing to gain and all to lose, especially their lives. They have always taught and trained you to believe it to be your patriotic duty to go to war and to have yourselves slaughtered at their command. But in all the history of the world, you, the people, have never had a voice in declaring war. And strange as it certainly appears, no war by any nation in any age has ever been declared by the people. The working class who fight all the battles, the working class who make the supreme sacrifices, the working class who freely shed their blood and furnish the corpses, have never yet had a voice in either declaring war or making peace. It is the ruling class that invariably does both. They alone declare war, and they alone make peace. Yours not to reason why, yours but to do and die. That is their motto, and we object on the part of the awakening workers of this nation. If war is right, let it be declared by the people.
Pat Tillman, former NFL player and Army Ranger, died in Afghanistan in 2004. The Pentagon and White House suppressed the real story, keeping even Tillman's family and his brother Kevin, who was still serving in Pat's battalion, in the dark. Tillman was actually killed by a member of his own unit, not an Afghan. Pat had been speaking to friends about the war in Iraq, which he thought was illegal, and his growing doubts about the war on terror. In 2006, his brother Kevin broke his silence as well.
It's Pat's birthday on November 6th. It gets me thinking about a conversation I had with Pat before we joined the military. He spoke about the risks with signing the papers, how once we committed, we were at the mercy of the American leadership and the American people. Much has happened since we handed over our voice. Somehow, we were sent to invade a nation because it was a direct threat to the American people, or to the world, or harbored terrorists, or was involved in the September 11 attacks, or received weapons-grade uranium from Niger, or had mobile weapon labs, or WMDs, or stop an insurgency, or stop a civil war we created that can't be called a civil war, even though it is. Somehow, our elected leaders were subverting international law and humanity by setting up secret prisons around the world, secretly kidnapping people, secretly holding them indefinitely, secretly not charging them with anything, secretly torturing them. Somehow, that overt policy of torture became the fault of a few bad apples in the military. Somehow back at home, Support for the soldiers meant having a 5-year-old kindergartner scribble a picture with crayons and send it overseas, or slapping stickers on a car. It's interesting. A soldier on his 3rd or 4th tour should care about a drawing from a 5-year-old or a faded sticker on a car as his friends die around him. Somehow, the more soldiers die, the more legitimate the illegal invasion becomes. Somehow, those afraid to fight an illegal invasion decades ago are allowed to send soldiers to die for an illegal invasion they started. Somehow, faking character, virtue, and strength is tolerated. Somehow, profiting from tragedy and horror is tolerated. Somehow, the death of tens, if not hundreds of thousands of people is tolerated. Somehow, subversion of the Bill of Rights and the Constitution is tolerated. Somehow, suspension of habeas corpus is supposed to keep this country safe. Somehow, torture is tolerated. Somehow, lying is tolerated. Somehow, reason is being discarded for faith, dogma, and nonsense. Somehow, American leadership managed to create a more dangerous world. Somehow, the same incompetent, narcissistic, virtuous, vacuous, malicious criminals are still in charge of this country. Somehow, this is tolerated. Somehow, nobody is accountable for this. Luckily, this country is still a democracy. People still have a voice. People still can take action.
One of the most outspoken opponents of the U.S. invasion attack on Mexico was Henry David Thoreau, who was jailed for refusing to pay a poll tax on the ground that the tax supported the war effort and therefore the extension of slavery. Here is a passage from his 1849 essay, Civil Disobedience.
I heartily accept the motto, that government is best which governs least, and I should like to see it acted up to more rapidly and systematically. Carried out, it finally amounts to this, which also I believe. That government is best which governs not at all. And when men are prepared for it, that will be the kind of government which they will have. Government is at best but an expedient. But most governments are usually, and all governments are sometimes, inexpedient. The objections which have been brought against a standing army, and they are many and weighty and deserve to prevail, may also at last be brought against a standing government. The standing army is only an arm of the standing government. The government itself, which is only the mode which the people have chosen to execute their will, is equally liable to be abused and perverted before the people can act through it. Witness the present Mexican War, the work of comparatively a few individuals using the standing government as their tool. For in the outset, the people would not have consented to this measure. Law never made men a whit more just, and by means of their respect for it, even the well-disposed are daily made the agents of injustice. A common and natural result of an undue respect for law is that you may see a file of soldiers, colonel, captain, corporal, privates, powder monkeys, and all, marching in admirable order over hill and dale to the wars, against their wills, aye, against their common sense and consciences, which makes it very steep marching indeed and produces a palpitation of the heart. They have no doubt that it is a damnable business in which they're concerned. They're all peaceably inclined. Now, what are they? Men at all? Or small movable forts and magazines at the service of some unscrupulous man in power? How does it become a man to behave toward this American government today? I answer that he cannot, without disgrace, be associated with it. I cannot for an instant recognize that political organization as my government, which is the slave's government also. All men recognize the right of revolution, that is, the right to refuse allegiance to and to resist the government when its tyranny or its inefficiency are great and unendurable. But almost all say that such is not the case now, but such was the case, they think, in the Revolution of 1775. If one were to tell me that this was a bad government because it taxed certain foreign commodities brought to its ports, it's most probable that I should not make an ado about it, for I can do without them. All machines have their friction, and possibly this does enough good to counterbalance the evil. At any rate, it's a great evil to make a stir about it. But when the friction comes to have its machine, and oppression and robbery are organized, I say, let's not have such a machine any longer. In other words, when a sixth of the population of a nation which has undertaken to be the refuge of liberty are slaves, and a whole country is unjustly overrun and conquered by a foreign army and subjected to military law, I think that it's not too soon for honest men to rebel and revolutionize. What makes this duty the more urgent is the fact that the country so overrun is not our own, but ours is the invading army.
In November of 1970, after his arrest, along with others who had engaged in a Boston protest at an army base to block soldiers from being sent to Vietnam, Howard Zinn flew to Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore to debate the philosopher Charles Frankel. But he had a tough choice that night because he was supposed to appear in court in connection with his arrest, and he had to decide whether to practice his commitment to civil disobedience. He chose to go to Baltimore, and here is part of what he said that night.
I start from the supposition that the world is topsy-turvy, that things are all wrong, that the wrong people are in jail and the wrong people are out of jail, that the wrong people are in power and the wrong people are out of power, that the wealth is distributed in this country and the world in such a way as not simply to require small reform, but to require a drastic reallocation of wealth. I start from the supposition that we don't have to say too much about this, because all we have to do is think about the state of the world today and realize that things are all upside down. Daniel Berrigan, a Catholic priest, a poet, is in jail, and J. Edgar Hoover is out of jail. At Kent State, four students were killed by the National Guard, and students were indicted. So we have to start from that supposition, that things are really topsy-turvy. And our topic is topsy-turvy. civil disobedience. As soon as you say the topic is civil disobedience, you're saying our problem is civil disobedience. That is not our problem. Our problem is civil obedience. Our problem is the numbers of people all over the world who have obeyed the dictates of the leaders of their government and have gone to war, and millions have been killed because of this obedience. We have to transcend these national boundaries in our thinking. Nixon and Brezhnev have much more in common with one another than we have with Nixon. J. Edgar Hoover has far more in common with the head of the Soviet police state, the secret police, than he has with us. That's why we're always surprised when they get together. They smile, they shake hands, they smoke cigars. They really like one another, no matter what they say. What we're trying to do, I assume, is really to get back to the principles and aims and spirit of the Declaration of Independence. This spirit is resistance to illegitimate authority and to forces that deprive people of their life and liberty and right to pursue happiness. And therefore, under these conditions, it urges the right to alter or abolish their current form of government. And the stress has been on abolish, but to establish the principles of the Declaration of Independence, we're going to need to go outside the law. My hope is that this kind of spirit will take place not just in this country, but in other countries, because they all need it. People in all countries need the spirit of disobedience to the state. And we need a kind of declaration of interdependence among people in all countries of the world who are striving for the same thing.
In 2010, Chelsea Manning, formerly known as Private First Class Bradley E. Manning, released hundreds of thousands of classified documents to the publisher WikiLeaks, including video of a 2007 US airstrike on Iraqi civilians that killed two Reuters journalists. Arrested several months later, Manning spent nearly a year in solitary confinement before facing court-martial on charges, including aiding the enemy. This is Manning's statement after she was sentenced to 35 years in federal prison.
The decisions that I made in 2010 were made out of a concern for my country, her citizens, and the wider world that we live in. Since the events of September 11th, 2001, the US has been involved in a war with an enemy that chose and chooses not to use a traditional battle space. Due to this fact, we altered our methods for combating the risks posed to us in America and our way of life. For a long time, I agreed with these methods. I chose to volunteer and help defend my country. However, it was not until I arrived in Iraq and was finally connecting the dots between the contents of often classified military and diplomatic documents that I worked with on a daily basis and real flesh and blood, that I realized in our efforts to meet the risks posed to us by our enemies, we had completely forgotten about our humanity. We consciously and repeatedly elected to devalue human life, both in Iraq and Afghanistan and now elsewhere. When we engaged those we perceived as the enemy, we often killed innocent civilians. And whenever we killed innocent civilians, we chose to not accept responsibility for these failures and instead hid behind a complex and growing veil of national security and classification in order to avoid public accountability. In our zeal to kill the enemy, we internally debated the definition of torture. We held individuals in Guantanamo Bay for years without due process of law. We inexplicably turned a blind eye to torture and executions by our host nation partners in Iraq and Afghanistan, and we stomached countless other recorded and documented acts in the name of our war on terror. All too often, patriotism is the cry extolled when morally and ethically questionable acts are advocated by those in power. When these cries of patriotism drown out any logically based intentions, it's usually the eager and dedicated American soldier on the ground that is given orders to carry out an ill-conceived mission. As the late Howard Zinn once said, there is not a flag large enough to cover the shame of killing innocent people. I understand that my actions violated the law, but I acted only out of a desire to help people. When I chose to disclose classified information to the public, I did so out of a love for my country, her citizens, and a sense of duty to others. I serve my time knowing that sometimes you have to pay a heavy price to live in a free society. I will gladly pay that price if it means we could have a country that is truly conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men and women are created equal.
In 1872, Susan B. Anthony was one of 14 women who defied the law to cast a ballot in the presidential election. She was arrested for knowingly voting without having a lawful right to vote, and later was found guilty. When her lawyer appealed the verdict, she addressed the court in response to a question from the judge.
Has the prisoner anything to say why sentence shall not be pronounced?
Yes, Your Honor, I have many things to say. For in your ordered verdict of guilty, you have trampled underfoot every vital principle of our government. My natural rights, my civil rights, my political rights, my judicial rights are all alike ignored. Robbed of the fundamental privilege of citizenship, I am degraded from the status of a citizen to that of a subject. And not only myself individually, but all of my sex are, by your honor's verdict, doomed to political subjection under this so-called Republican form of government.
The court cannot listen to a rehearsal of argument which the prisoner's counsel has already consumed 3 hours
in presenting.
May it please,
Your Honor, I am not arguing the question, but simply stating the reasons why sentence cannot, in justice, be pronounced against me. Your denial of my citizen's right to vote is the denial of my right of consent as one of the governed, the denial of my right of representation as one of the taxed, the denial of my right to a trial by a jury of my peers as an offender against the law. Therefore, the denial of my sacred right to life, liberty,
The court cannot allow the prisoner to go on.
May it please the court to remember that since the day of my arrest last November, this is the first time that either myself or any person of my disfranchised class has been allowed a word of defense before judge or jury.
The prisoner must sit down. The court cannot allow it.
Of all my prosecutors, from the corner grocery politician who entered the complaint, to the United States Marshal, Commissioner, District Attorney, District Judge, Your Honor on the bench. Not one is my peer, but each and all are my political sovereigns. And had Your Honor submitted my case to the jury, as was clearly your duty, even then should I have had just cause of protest, for not one of those men was my peer, but each and every man of them was my political superior.
The court must insist. The prisoner has been tried according to the established forms of law.
Yes, Your Honor. But by forms of law, all made by men, interpreted by men, administered by men, in favor of men and against women. And hence, Your Honor's ordered verdict of guilty against a United States citizen for the exercise of the citizen's right to vote, because that citizen was a woman and not a man. But yesterday, the same man-made forms of law declared it a crime punishable with a $1,000 fine and 6 months imprisonment to give a cup of cold water, a crust of bread, or a night's shelter to a panting fugitive tracking his way to Canada. And every man or woman in whose veins coursed a drop of human sympathy violated that law, reckless of consequences, and was justified in doing so. As then the slaves who got their freedom had to take it over or under or through the unjust forms of law, precisely so now must women take it to get a right to a voice in this government. And I have taken mine, and I will take it at every opportunity.
The court orders the prisoner to sit down. It will not allow another word.
When I was brought before your honor for trial, I had hoped for a broad and liberal interpretation of the Constitution and its recent amendments, but failing to get this, failing even to get a trial by a jury not of my peers, I ask not leniency at your hands, but rather the full rigors of the law.
Okay. The court must insist. The sentence of the court is that you pay a fine of $100 and the costs of prosecution.
May it please your honor, I will never pay a dollar of your unjust penalty. All the stock in trade I possess is a debt of $10,000 incurred by publishing my paper, The Revolution, the sole object of which was to educate all women to do precisely as I have done, rebel against your man-made, unjust, unconstitutional forms of law, which tax, fine, imprison, and hang women while denying them the right of representation in the government. And I will work with might and main to pay back every dollar of my honest debt, but not a penny shall go to this unjust claim. And I shall earnestly and persistently continue to urge all women in the practical recognition of that old revolutionary maxim, resistance to tyranny is obedience to God.
In 1937, a Bronx schoolteacher, Abel Mirapol, saw a gruesome picture of two black teenagers who had been lynched in Indiana 7 years earlier. Afterwards, he wrote the haunting poem, Bitter Fruit. He was a member of the Communist Party and published the words to the song in the New York Teacher and the New Masses. But fame for the song came after he showed it to the extraordinary blues singer, Billie Holiday. Though her record company refused to record the song, she released it through a specialty label under the title Strange Fruit.
Southern trees bear a strange fruit. Blood on the blood at the root, black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar tree. Pastoral scene of the gallant south, big bulging eyes and a twist stared mouth, scent of magnolia clean and fresh. Then the sudden smell of burning flesh,
for the crows to pluck, for the rain to gather, for the wind to suck, for the sun to rise, for the leaves to drop. Here is a strange and bitter crop.
On August 28th, 2013, tens of thousands of people poured onto the National Mall for the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington. But some voices were excluded that day. Philip Agnew, a leader of the youth activist group Dream Defenders, which launched in the aftermath of the murder of Florida teen Trayvon Martin, was one organizer whose scheduled speaking time was cut. In a YouTube video posted later that day, he suggested what he wanted to say that day.
By the time we finish our conversation this morning, another black boy will lay bleeding in the streets of Chicago. And as we rest our heads tonight, 300,000 of our veterans will lay their heads homeless. And I would love to explain to you how the hate we spread abroad is the real reason that hatred washes upon our shores, but I only have 2 minutes. And I can tell you that Philadelphia just closed 23 of its schools at the same time it makes way for a $400 million state-of-the-art prison, and that North Carolina and Florida continue to silence their citizens at the ballot box, but I only have 2 minutes. I could tell you how, even as we celebrate Dr. King's dream, over 400,000 of our immigrant brothers and sisters languish away in privately owned detention camps. And how we still find our queer brothers and sisters in prison in the shadows of their closets, but I only have 2 minutes. And I tell you how our mothers, sisters, wives, and daughters still earn less, have no control over their bodies, and are traded and trafficked like slaves. And I could tell you how it's easier for someone to buy a gun and put it to their head than it is to diagnose the illness within it, but I only have 2 minutes. And if there was time, I would tell you that millions of young people and queer people and poor people and people of color are asking, what do we do with all of this anger, all this fear, this disappointment and frustration, this madness that we feel? But alas, I only have 1 minute. And with it, this last minute of our conversation, I tell you that though all may seem lost, there is a generation of dreamers and lovers and defenders and builders bubbling, bubbling, bubbling beneath the rubble. And beneath your feet, you may feel a collective quaking, tremors of a sleeping giant awakening, emanating from fault lines at the Arizona-Mexico border and Raleigh and in Austin and in Cleveland, Ohio and Chicago, Illinois and even Tallahassee, Florida. And we've come here from every crack, crease, and crevice of our country to our capital to say that for all those whose cares have been our concern, we are ready. To say to anybody who believes that we will be co-opted or we will be bought, that we're ready. And for those that doubt our energy and our resolve and our discipline, we are ready. For those that believe that future fingers may fail the torch, fear not, we're ready. For all those that believe in the power of nonviolence and love as unconquerable, we are ready. 50 years ago, a man told us of a promised land, and for 50 years, we've wandered and wondered, where are the youth? The constant whispers in our ear, and so we have come, asking neither permission nor questions, but to answer one and to say that we are here, believing indeed that we have a beautiful history and that the one we will build in the future will truly astonish the world. We are ready. May the outcome always prosper over income, peace over profit, revolution over revenue, and all peace and power to the people. For anybody who doubts us, don't believe us, just watch. We are ready. Thank you.
One of the best known songs of the Depression era was written by Yip Harburg, "Brother, Can You Spare a Dime?"
Once I built a railroad, made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once I built a tower to the sun, brick and rivet and line. Once I built a tower, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once in khaki suits, gee, we look swell, full of that Yankee doodle dum. Half a million boots went slogging through hell, and I was a kid with a drum. Oh, say, do you was Al all the time. Say, don't you remember I'm your pal? Brother, can you spare a dime. A
9-day strike of Chicago teachers in September 2012 ended with a decisive victory against Mayor Rahm Emanuel and his drive to impose a corporate agenda on the public education system. After the victory, a teacher, Kirsten Roberts, a member of the CTU, reflected on lessons from the strike.
I began teaching in 2006. My first jobs were at social service agencies contracting with Chicago Public Schools to provide preschool on the cheap. These were non-union, very low benefits, very long working hours, high staff, turnover jobs. They were also jobs working with some of the poorest and highest needs kids in the city. Kids with HIV, foster kids, kids with histories of extreme abuse, kids with cognitive and physical impairments. This combination, kids with the greatest needs, getting the least experience and worst compensated teachers, is of course no coincidence. One of the great contributions of the Chicago Teachers Union strike of 2012 is that this realization about our public education system and how the education deformers are transforming teachers into a short-term, lower-skill, lower-wage job, and is now being discussed not by a few, but by millions. Robbing the poor to pay the rich, and then having the nerve to blame the poor and the people who teach them for the very conditions the rich created? This is education policy in the richest country on earth. The Chicago Teachers Union strike, I believe, has made an important contribution of pushing these crimes into the spotlight as well. Yesterday at school, we ran out of hand soap. We took the children to the bathroom, and as they lined up to wash their hands, we realized our pump soap was running out. My heart sank because I knew that I had no more soap in my supply locker. This is a small thing, a minor thing, but it's also a big thing. See, we aren't provided soap in the bathrooms at our school. There isn't room in the budget. We beg our parents to donate soap to us, or we buy it out of our measly supply budget, or we pay for it out of pocket. It's hard to explain, but these are the daily, petty failures that add up over time. The message becomes so clear. You and your students aren't worth it. If nobody had soap, if there was a worldwide soap shortage, then it wouldn't hurt. But it's obvious that some people's children will always have clean hands and so much more. Some people's children will go to schools with 7 full-time art teachers. Some children will go to school with none. Some children will go to schools where student-to-teacher ratios are 9-1. And some children will go to kindergarten with 42 5-year-old friends and 1 teacher. It's not hard to guess who children gets the things that make school worthwhile and enriching and whose children don't. The greatest contribution of this strike is highlighting for all to see this injustice being perpetuated unto our children. This strike alone couldn't solve this injustice, but asserting that all children deserve what Rahm Emanuel's and Penny Prexter's children get, we have contributed to the building of a movement that in no small measure will be able to mobilize the kind of power necessary to tackle the iniquities. As we all know, round 2 is coming, and we must prepare and go stronger than we were in round 1, because their side is also drawing lessons, planning, and preparing. Round 2 is shaping up to be the battle over school closures. Rumors are swirling, but one thing is certain. Chicago Public Schools plans more closures and turnarounds of failing schools than we've ever seen before. And as we enter into this next fight, it is important than ever that we don't lose the sight of the significance of what we're fighting for. On that note, let me quote from a letter the staff at my school sent home to our families when we returned from the strike. We fought for the belief that all students can learn and deserve high quality public education. We fought for the right to safe, healthy, well-maintained school buildings. We fought for class size reduction because the number of students per teacher does make a difference. We fought to stop excessive student testing. We fought for more social services that our students need. We fought for equal investment and funding for all schools, for equality and equity in education. We fought for an end of poverty and violence that so many of our students struggle with every day. We also know that we must continue to stay committed to the realization of these beliefs and rights.
Roberto Meneses Marquez is the president of the Day Laborers United, and he's here tonight along with fellow workers in that organization. They're a group of workers fighting for the right of precarious day laborers, many of them undocumented. Here he talks about his organizing efforts.
I am an undocumented day laborer in Queens who has worked in this country for almost 20 years. I do hard, dangerous construction jobs, such as demolition or carrying out the trash, when I can get any work at all. I've known many men who've been killed in workplace accidents, who've become gravely ill from breathing in dust due to lack of adequate protective equipment. We deserve the chance to become full members of the society we contribute to every day. For the past decade, I've heard much of in the media about possible immigration reform law. But I've learned not to believe it. In the early 2000s, there was talk of the United States and Mexico reaching a comprehensive deal to legalize all undocumented immigrants in return for a free trade deal that would allow private investment into Pemex, Mexico's state-owned oil company. Those talks fell apart after September 11th. During his 2004 re-election campaign, President George W. Bush once again raised the hopes of immigration reform to woo the Latino vote. But it was an empty promise. In 2006, we went out into the streets by the millions, and our demands continued to be ignored. Far from being a solution, work permits are instruments of exploitation for immigrant workers on both sides of the border. In immigrants' countries of origin, unscrupulous brokers collect large fees, promising to help arrange work permits, and then disappear with the people's money. On this side of the border, the bosses expose the workers to long, hard hours of labor in unhealthy conditions, and without necessary protections. And if the workers don't like it, then they lose their jobs and their work permits. Creating a new set of work permits without a real path to permanent residency and citizenship will only legalize the exploitation we live under while requiring us to go to the back of the line and pay thousands in fines and more taxes for this privilege of being treated this way. The citizens' bipartisan gang of eight may think they're fooling us, but I cannot swallow this deception. The distrust I feel comes from observing two successive presidential administrations, one Republican and the other Democrat. They speak both from both sides of their mouths. One, they spew words of legalization, but on the other side, they generate more anti-immigration laws, increase deportations, build detention centers and jails, and pour more investment into policing the border. I am 45 years old, as are many of the people I work with in construction. And it appears increasingly likely that we will not live long enough to be legalized. This is unjust. After almost two decades in this country, there are a couple of things I've learned. Firstly, don't trust the politicians. And secondly, it will only be through our own ability to organize and collectively fight for our rights that we will see improvements in our lives.
Marge Piercy's poetry speaks powerfully and eloquently for a new world and challenges us to act. We end our program tonight with her 1977 poem, The Low Road.
What can they do to you? Whatever they want. They can set you up, they can bust you, they can break your fingers, they can burn your brain with electricity, blur you with drugs till you can't walk. Can't remember, they can take your child, wall up your lover. They can do anything. You can't blame them from doing. How can you stop them? Alone, you can fight. You can refuse. You can take what revenge you can. But they roll over you. But two people fighting, back to back, can cut through a mob. A snake dancing file can break a cordon. An army can meet an army. Two people can keep each other sane, can give support, conviction, love, massage, hope, sex. Three people are a delegation, a committee, a wedge. With four, you can play bridge and start an organization. With six, you can rent a whole house, eat pie for dinner with no seconds, and hold a fundraising party. A dozen can make a demonstration. 100 can fill a hall. 1,000 have solidarity and your own newsletter. 10,000, power and your own paper. 100,000, your own media. 10 million, your own country. It goes on one at a time. It starts when you care to act. It starts when you do what you do again after they said no. It starts when you say we, and you know who you mean. And each day, you mean one more.
Thanking DJ Charlie Hustle, who is bringing the beats before the show, Aaron Cherry, Stacey Ann Chin, Kevin Koble, Elizabeth Davis, Brian Jones, Malcolm London, Kelly McDonald, Diva Mahal, Allison Moore, Vigo Mortensen, Adeparo Duye, Jessica Pimentel, Susan Porfar, Peter Sarsgaard, Wallace Shawn, and Jeff Zinn. Thank you.